Good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm really, really excited and honored and privileged to be speaking with you today about your commission poem for the Major Taylor mural. And I am a fan of your work, and I had the privilege of reading your work and just found it stunning. And so I am really excited for the city to hear your work and for the world to hear your work. And so I just want to ask you a little bit about yourself. I'm curious about your artistic background and when you began writing and who were the people or the poets that influenced you.
Okay. My artistic background. So I have always been a performer, and as a little kid, I was always telling stories. Mm-hmm. Telling stories in my backyard, mm-hmm. with my sister. I always loved reading and writing too. Yeah, yeah. And I remember when I was little, I loved historical fiction. Mm-hmm. And so I would just write stories like that. And as I got older, I would say it was probably when I was in high school is when I started really just being keyed into writers like Maya Angelou. Mm-hmm. She was actually probably the first poet I read where I was just moved,
yeah.
Which I think she did that for a lot of people.
Yeah, myself yeah. included.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But even then, I wasn't really, I would write poetry and stuff, but I wasn't really sharing it with anyone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then when I went to college, I was still like scribbling my poems in a notebook and stuff mm-hmm. like that. And mm-hmm. I stumbled upon old recordings of Deaf Poetry Jam mm. on YouTube.
Yeah.
And I was just zoned in. I said, this yeah. is it. And I was like, this is what I want to do. Yeah. These people are so cool. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, that was for me when I realized I could start performing poetry. But even yeah. then, I was scared.
Yes.
And yes. yeah. it wasn't until I started, I was an intern with the Indiana Writer Center. Mm-hmm. I was going into my senior year of college. So it was the summer between my junior and senior year. Mm-hmm. And I was teaching high school students about spoken word poetry, and they were like, Miss Kelsey, have you performed? And I was like, no.
Right, yeah.
And I was mm-hmm. like, I'm telling these kids that they need to be sharing their stories and their voices and their words with the world, but I'm not doing it. Mm. And so when I went back to college for senior year, I was like, okay, this is the time you're gonna start not only writing more, but also sharing out loud. And that's kind of been my journey ever since then.
Ah, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
That
the kids made me do it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that was a good catalyst.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, thank you for sharing that, your journey with loving poetry mm-hmm. and reading it, but then holding it as this very private art
mm-hmm.
until you were ready, and mm-hmm. that, you know, helped kind of find your voice, because I always find that it's important to just find your inner voice mm-hmm. before you try to start writing for the world.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something kind of sacred just like about when you're just writing when no one else knows about it and no one else is listening.
Yep.
So you studied acting, and I'm interested because you were not a spoken word poet at first, but I am interested in what elements of theater and acting do you find inform your work now as a spoken word poet?
Yeah. I mean, I definitely think it's the emotional life, and mm-hmm. it's also the storytelling. Because when I write a poem, mm-hmm. I am crafting a journey that I want to take the audience on, the reader, on this journey with me,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. and every good story has a beginning, middle, and an end.
Yes.
And that I learned about the very best kind of storytelling when you're on stage and you've got the audience drawn in and you go on this wild ride in a play. I wanted to bring that same kind of storytelling into my poetry performance.
Mm-hmm.
So that is part of it, but I'll also just say, what I learned when I was in school, I tell people this all the time, they taught us how to be actors, but really it's teaching us how to be more human and just be more in tune with your emotions. And have your emotions be right there under the surface, because as an actor, you want to be able to display the wide range of human emotions and what we go through so that the audience can understand and go on that journey. And so for me as a poet, even if the words are not my own, like if I've recited a poem by someone else, it's still really important for me to just tap into that emotional life.
Absolutely. And you tapped into it with the poem that you composed for this mural, and I just found it striking. And so I would actually kind of like to talk about the poem itself, since so when I first read it, and I began just with the first lines, the spirit of it reminded me of Baby Sook's Sermon in the Clearing from Toni Morrison's
Beloved. Yeah.
And so right away I was pulled in, because it felt like there was this ancestral summoning, and the whole piece actually rides on that power. And so in the novel, Baby Suggs is the griot. She's the mother-like figure. And so she invites the community of these beautiful humans who are descendants of enslaved Africans. And she is inviting them into this embodied hope and this embodied redemption. And so I felt that.
You're making me teary-eyed.
As I entered the piece, it was so powerful, and the words. And when we finally reach that day, it will be glorious. I'm talking about you, the collective, all of us. And listen closely. I'm talking about you, little black boy with the ashy knees. And another thing that I love is that you start with the universal. Right? So the collective. So when you say all of us, so you're inviting everybody. And then it's like we're all drawn into the poem and we're listening. So you start with the universal, with the collective, but then you get it down to the particular. Little black boy with ashy knees. And I thought, oh, that's brilliant how she did that, right? So I'm wanting to know if that was an intentional choice when you made that shift of inviting the universal, the collective black experience, but then little black boy talking to you, you with the ashy knees. So talk about that a little bit, if you will.
Yeah. So I'll say this. As I was thinking about what I wanted to say in this piece, it was really important to me that everyone was drawn in, and yes, Major Taylor was a black man, but his story is all of our stories.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
And so because of that, I think that sometimes, in my experience, when I've had conversations with people, especially about black history, black American history, there's an othering and a distancing, and really it's our collective history. It's our collective story. And so because of that, I wanted everyone to be drawn in immediately and to say, this is all of our story together. As well as, I'll say, you know, when, again, when we in the black community lose someone at the hands of violence, and it becomes, I feel the loss, even if it's not personal kin, right?
Yeah.
It again, I remember someone said, there was a young black man who had died, and someone said, he was all of ours. And I just wanted that to be a reminder that even when I honed in on this little black boy with the ashy knees, because I've known a few of those, I'm like, put some lotion on. He's all of ours. Yeah. And yes, I'm talking to him, but he is all of ours. Yes. It's our duty. It's our responsibility to lift him up.
Yes, yes. And you so beautifully accomplished that here. And it is felt right at the beginning. And so you are someone who loves history. Mm-hmm. And so as a student of history, I am curious about when you first encountered Major Taylor's story, because as a Hoosier, someone born and raised here, and you are too, mm-hmm. To my regret, I did not learn about Major Taylor, like so many others, until I was an adult.
Right.
And I just think about that, and I'm just like, how could that happen? You know, I went to public schools, and I went to college in Indiana, and I never heard about Major Taylor and his story and his legend until after I left college. And so I'm interested in when you first encountered his story, as well as what particular stories in your research process and in learning like about him helped to inspire this piece.
Mm-hmm. Well, like you, it wasn't until after college that I even heard of him. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even really dive deep until this project. And I thought, what a cool opportunity to learn more about this great man. And there's so many interesting things about his life. Mm. But I will say there were a few things that moved me. Mm-hmm. Just in general, his autobiography, which is very long. It's got a lot of words. Like, mm-hmm. man could write. He had a lot to say. Mm-hmm. But what moved me about even just the purpose behind his autobiography is that he really wanted to, the way I see it, as kick open the door for the next generation, to leave the door open so other people could follow behind him. And he wanted the younger generations to know that you could do this. Mm-hmm. You can do this. Mm-hmm. This is possible for you. Mm. And as I was driving here today, I was actually thinking more about that and how so many of us, at least I'll speak for myself, I get caught up in the here and the now and the present.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And not thinking about the steps that I could be taking and the things I could be doing to just make things better for the coming generations, right? Mm-hmm. And so I was really moved by that mindset that he had, mm-hmm. because he died relatively young too.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But then also, as I was reading and listening to stories about his life, honestly, there's one story that I heard it in a podcast, and then I was like, I have to go back, because I had read pieces of his autobiography. I have to go back and find this story, and I'm getting teary-eyed thinking about it, because it's the story that for me, as soon as I heard it, I was like, this is how I want to bring this image in when I start writing. Mm-hmm. And he, like I said, he was someone who was so much about setting a standard and making a way for coming generations. And mm-hmm. he really put himself out there. And this was really early on in his career. He was still just doing some small races, and there was one race where, so the other people who were in the race didn't know that he was going to be there because they were all white. And so the person who wanted him to be in the race was like, we'll put you on after. So like everyone else started the race, and then he started after them.
Yeah.
And they didn't know that he was behind them.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, when they realized he was behind them and he had kind of caught up with them, the people in the race started calling him names, started threatening him, threatening bodily harm, and he was scared. He thought that they were going to lynch him. Mm-hmm. And he actually said that, you know, he came to this part in the road where there were all these trees and there were willows hanging low, and he thought, well, great, there are people that could be hiding there to hurt me.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so he kept riding, though, that's the thing. He kept riding. Mm. He just buckled down, and he ended up riding through a rainstorm.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came out on the other side, he finished first, and he finished over an hour ahead of the second man.
Wow.
Yes. Wow. And when I read that story, I thought, wow, what a metaphor for life.
Yes, yes.
Running the race, riding the race marked out for you, despite the chaos, despite people calling you names or trying to hurt you, literally, metaphorically. And that story, like I said, that was very early on in his career, but for me, I feel like that just encompassed so much of what he set out to do.
Yeah. And you infuse that in your third stanza, and that's where he enters the piece. And so there is this soft kind of dialogue, but I love it because it's so as you say, or as you write, and you say, I've been going round and round in this thing called life. Got those storm clouds rolling in and hanging low. Got every kind of kin swinging from those sappy trees. I don't know how to glory in this gloom. Don't know how to shake free the dust and keep going. So you are interweaving that metaphor of his life. And I was like, oh, he is writing, right? His course, and this is also a metaphor for his life. You know, it was very clear, but it was almost like this dialogue was in his head. So it was like we were overhearing him thinking, and I thought, oh yeah, that's also another brilliant choice that you decided to construct there. That just makes this so very powerful. And I'm equally interested in knowing about the title, From the Earth to the Stars, and why you chose that, or what inspired that.
Yeah. Well, I always write the title at the end, after I write the whole piece, that I'm kind of listening, and I'm like, what is the title of this piece?
Yeah.
And as I was thinking about his life and the struggle, the struggles that he went through, I just, there's, so Dr. King, in his final speech that he gave before he was assassinated, right, he talks about, how, you know, he's seen the promised land, right?
Yeah.
And even though he didn't get there with us here on Earth, he's seen the promised land. And I think a lot about those who came before us, those who came before me, who were riding the course, right?
Yes.
They're running the race marked out for them. And my mom always says, God gives you just enough light for the step that you're on. And so they can't necessarily see what's ahead of them, but they just keep going. Yes. But there is glory on the other side.
Yeah.
And so for me, part of thinking about Major Taylor's life is he went through it here on Earth. And he got some glory and some acclaim, right, here on Earth. But I don't know if he could have known the impact, right, that he would have today, that we would be painting a mural and writing about him.
And doing this.
Yes, and doing this. Uh-huh. And so for me, it's about that journey from here on Earth to glory, whatever glory looks like for you.
Yeah. And that is so evident here of sort of wanting to pass on this wisdom. And so there is that generational, like I said, summoning that you include here. And every time you make the choice to keep going, we go deeper. So again, including all of us into this story. And one of the things that I also love about this piece and what you've done in speaking about his extraordinary athletic accomplishments. I mean, you know, he was doing this, you know, at the height of Jim Crow. And I was reading something that he wrote, and he said, I didn't have anybody to mentor me. So, you know, you are speaking about, you know, how we even prepare the next generation by our actions. And he was saying, I had no one to mentor me. You know, he said, you know, I mean, really, who had ever been in this spot, right? Because he was the first black man to ever win a world championship in cycling. He was the second African-American to win a world championship in any sport. So truly, he was a pioneer. He was a trailblazer. And he was doing this at a time when it was just incredibly hard, beyond what we can fathom. And what I like about what you did is that you didn't just speak to his legend, you spoke to his humanity. Mm-hmm. You spoke to the little boy, the little Major Taylor with the dreams that was just working at the bicycle shops and doing the stunts, and that's how he got the name.
And who loved his mom.
And who loved his mom. The soft, you know? And so I got teary-eyed reading your piece, because it wasn't just you were pointing to those big accomplishments, although they are here, but you went back to the little boy in him. Because I found the end of his life sad, you know, that he died indigent, and that he was trying to literally going from door to door, trying to sell his autobiography, and that, you know, he died, you know, in a hospital ward in Chicago, separated from his wife and his daughter. Mm-hmm. And I thought he did all of that, and then this is how he died, you know, and it made me sad. But what your piece did is you revived him by speaking to the little boy in him that just had those early dreams, like we all do, right? Before we encounter the world, you know, we just have those innocent dreams of what we can do, and that anything is possible. And then we enter into the world and we know, oh, my blackness is a factor. It's more complicated than what I thought. And another reason why I'm just really thankful that, again, you spoke to the humanity is because, you know, interestingly, like enough, you know, this week as I've been watching the Olympics, and like we all have, and looking at Simone Biles, and I was watching her, and I was listening to the sports commentator, the way that, and what she has done is just extraordinary. It's just beyond what's been done. And so, and they were just saying, oh, I mean, like, it was like she was superhuman. And when black people do extraordinary things, it's like we're either superhuman or not human, like, at all.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And so it's like we're always holding this very strange paradox. And even Simone, like, it was just too hot, you know, she's like, this is a lot. So just in thinking about Simone Biles and being in the Olympics right now and being the best in the world at what she does and the hard work that she has put in to get there. But then on top of that, right, just being a black person, being a black woman, you know, in the world just every day.
Yes.
It's difficult and it's challenging. But then to be, you know, a world-class athlete, that just compounds it. And she said, I didn't know. So because people were really supporting her, she says, I didn't know that I was more than just a gymnast. She said that because for the first time for her, she's like, I can also be human, you know? And so what you did was you spoke not just to, just the extraordinary athlete and legend, but the human in Major Taylor, and that's so important, and that's so important for our journey. And if you also like want to add to that, but I think that was just an incredible choice and a very brave choice that you made in this piece.
Well, thank you. I'll just say, just to echo a little bit of what you said, the reason why I wanted to focus on his humanity so much and the doubts and the wrestling is because it is so easy, I think, when these people become larger than life,
yes,
because of the things that they're doing, which are incredible. I'm not very athletic, I'll say it. Mm-hmm. Like it's hard to look at them and think he couldn't have possibly had any doubts,
right,
or any fears, mm-hmm, or even think about just the mental toll that
absolutely
it took,
yeah,
because he was getting death threats.
Yeah.
He was assaulted by someone. You know, it wasn't an easy thing, and it's so easy, I think, to celebrate his life and, mm-hmm, and talk about it in this grandiose way.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we also need to celebrate his humanity and to acknowledge that as a human, as a man, he went through it,
mm-hmm,
and he prevailed.
Yes, yes, he did. He prevailed. And you are also an educator.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was infused here, right? So
mm-hmm,
all of the little boys, the black boys and the brown boys that you see every day.
Oh, I was thinking of them when I was writing this.
Mm.
Little black boy with the ashy knees.
Yeah.
I saw so many of my former students. I saw them,
mm-hmm,
and remembered conversations about their dreams,
mm,
and the things I was trying to speak into their life.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Yes. And it's beautifully represented. And did you think about the visual aspect of how the poem would look? Did you think about that much? I'm curious about that.
I did.
Since it will be red, right? Like,
yes,
like alongside the mural, the visual art.
I did think about it. It actually started out in a very different format than
okay
than what
yeah
it is now. But because his life kind of, to me, as I was reading, it just felt like an epic story.
Mm, mm-hmm.
And so it kind of, the way that I wrote the piece just kind of took on this form for me of this is an epic story that needs to be told. And
yeah,
I didn't want it to feel, because some pieces, you know, it's like a line here and a line there, and it's very poetic and,
mm-hmm,
kind of graceful. But I just wanted,
yeah,
all the words came pouring out of me when,
mm-hmm,
I sat down to write. And so I just wanted it to just,
yeah,
look that way on the page.
Yeah. Wonderful. And so you did the inverse thing. You went from the, and then the exit to the poem is the universe, like again.
Mm-hmm.
So we emerge from the periphery singing, you are, we are. And so I thought that was a very profound choice, right? So again, we all are Major Taylor's story,
mm-hmm,
and we all have it, and we're all living, and we're all pressing, we're all running this race,
mm-hmm,
in the course set out for us, and that we are capable. And so what do you want people to take away,
hmm,
from this piece?
Oh, wow. I was thinking about that earlier today. I said, what do
you
do
knew I was going to ask
yes
you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, I really think it goes back to that story that I,
mm-hmm,
said about him riding through that rainstorm and through people saying all kinds of terrible things to him,
mm-hmm,
on top of Jim Crow, right? All of,
yeah,
these things, the world is pressing in on him. And he rode through that rainstorm,
yeah,
and he came out on the other side, and,
yeah,
on the other side was the glory.
Yes, there we go.
And I really want, there is hope.
Mm-hmm.
You can be encouraged. You can ride your race and get to the finish line.
Mm-hmm.
And also that we are there to support each other and lift,
yes,
each other up. And,
yes,
you, like you said, he didn't have anyone who was doing it with him,
mm-hmm,
who went before him, but we have a responsibility.
Yes.
And so I want people to be encouraged by that.
From the earth to the stars.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Kelsey. It's been
thank
an
you
honor. So, thank you for being the vessel. Yes, thank you.
Thank you.